Before I get started, two things. One, I neglected to mention yesterday, because I didn't know until early this morning, I want to thank Father Norm for giving the opening prayer, but it was also his birthday yesterday. So let's say happy birthday to Father Norm. Thank you, Father Norm. Don's right. I did spend part of my work career at Swenson's. There's a good part and a bad part. It was an excellent place to work. You did learn about customer service. The bad part is I do remember what most of you tipped. Thank you. No, I'm serious, I did. Thank you, Don, and good afternoon. Don Taylor is not only the leader of the Greater Akron Chamber, one of the city's most important partners, but also on a personal level, Don has extended himself into the business and civic life of Akron, and we have benefited from the entrepreneurial spirit he has shared with so many people. For that, we are all grateful. Thank you, Don. This year's State of the City is hosted by the Akron Roundtable, co-sponsored by the Greater Akron Chamber, Leadership Akron, and the Akron Kiwanis Club, and the Rotary Club of Akron. My thanks to these organizations for working together to host this event. And let us thank the chefs, servers, laborers, management team here at the Knight Center for their continued hard work. Thank you. A year ago, I said our city is on the verge of a renaissance, a time when we can create stronger and more stable neighborhoods and a robust economy that reaches all of us. And 12 months later, I believe we have taken major steps to make those promises a reality. In this past year, we have set the table for a new Akron, one that is poised to innovate and grow. Having said that, we are keenly aware of the challenges that we continue to face as we look to take our place among the best urban areas of the country. As I review some of our successes this past year, please know that this is a result of a hard-working team of leaders at City Hall in my cabinet and the 1,800 employees who are dedicated to making Akron a great place to live and work. With the approval of voters last spring, we quickly formed the new Department of Human Resources to better manage the workforce that serves all of us every day. And we have worked to develop stronger partnerships with Akron City Council. It was very important to me to reset our relationship to move this city forward. They have joined me on numerous occasions in putting forth solutions for some of our most difficult problems. I'd like to ask Council President Marilyn Keith and all the members of Akron City Council here to please stand and join me in recognizing their service to our community. Thank you to all of you. All of this, for me, is not possible, like Don said, without the support and love of my family. I've been blessed to be married for 22 years to my wife, Deanna, three beautiful children. My sisters and my mom are here. My brother didn't want to come, but that's okay. But if you don't have that support at home, it really helps. It takes a lot for me. There's decompression places, and the home is where it is for us. And we've made a home there, and we continue to you know, we'll do that and see our children grow and stay here. And that's one of the whole focuses is to try and do that. 2016 was an interesting year. I held 6 town halls, one in each different area of the city, and a youth town hall that brought together students from every one of Akron's high schools. I met with every senior class in the Akron Public Schools. I convened Akron's inaugural Health Equity Summit for leaders of health and social services, our faith community, our educators, and our residents, as promised. In June, we honored LeBron James with a party that 30,000 of you attended in downtown Akron. We designated a portion of Main Street King James Way after our hometown hero sealed the long overdue, I say that again, the long overdue championship for Northeast Ohio, the first in 50 years. Thank you. He needs a bigger round of applause than that. Come on, thank you. Plus, we went to the same high school, but that's a whole different story. On a more serious note, and in August, we said goodbye to our dear friend, Russ Pry, a great friend to many of us, and the executive. We will all miss his leadership, his smile, and his uncanny wit. In November, we celebrated the election of Sama County's first female executive in Eileen Shapiro, who's with us today. Thank you, Eileen. Eileen is a very important partner for me and for the city. I look forward to seeing what we will achieve together. I have learned in 2016, after listening to the collective wisdom of all of our residents, our business leaders, and our children, is that we have an untapped reservoir of goodwill, an appreciation for our history, and a supply of energy that bodes well for our future. Those that live and work here want to see Akron grow and succeed. I believe they will give us the tools to meet their expectations. As you might expect, one of the first things that residents care most about is the massive $1.4 billion sewer project and its impact on utility bills. Even before I took the oath on New Year's Day in 2016, I made arrangements to meet with the EPA in Washington and reach out to the federal court that oversees the largest construction program in the history of our city. 12 months later, I can report to you substantial progress. Construction of new infrastructure is on time, and importantly, I can tell you that we've accomplished my early goal of seeing the total cost of the program reduced. In the past year, work has been completed on 4 storage basins that will reduce the amount of untreated sewage flowing into our waterways by millions of gallons after heavy rain. By the end of all of the sewer projects, and these are some numbers that you kind of have to get your hands around, 1.6 billion gallons of untreated sewage a year will be removed from our waterways. And that's the equivalent of over about 100,000 swimming pools on a yearly basis out of our rivers. So that, I think, is a tagline for an applause. The single largest project of all is the construction of a mile-long tunnel under downtown. Our tunnel boring machine, named Rosie, is being built as we speak and will arrive for work by early this summer. As soon as she's on site, I will invite all of you, our school children, and the community to see this awe-inspiring machine up close. And in case you didn't know, Rosie is the name of a real person, Rose Mae Jacob from Kenmore, who, with hundreds of other women, helped America win the Second World War by working in Akron's rubber factories. By working with the EPA, we've been able to cut $30 million from the cost estimate of the total project. And with the changes, we also get clean water benefits sooner, remove fewer trees, and eliminate disruption along the towpath trail. In fact, we have committed to replace every single tree removed during the sewer projects with 2 new trees. By refinancing long-term debt, we were able to save another $18 million over the life of the project. So, in my first year, we have cut the cost to the ratepayers by more than $50 million. As most of you know, and I realize this on a daily and a weekly basis, this is not nearly enough. We must continue to bring these costs down while seeking better financing options to pay for them. Another high priority for all of us is safety. We see the scourge of drugs and violence around the country, and here we are not immune. With regards to opiates and their replacement by heroin, often laced with fentanyl, Akron and Summit County have been at the center of this epidemic. In response, I directed our police department to ensure that our patrol cars carry the antidote Narcan, and that police officers on the street were trained on how to use it. It has made a significant difference. And every day, we see our police officers and EMTs saving lives. I'd like to take a moment now to thank Akron's first responders for their continued commitment to bravely serve our citizens each and every day. Thank you, guys. In 2017, Akron will establish quick response teams comprised of a police officer, a medic, and a treatment counselor who will reach out to those who have overdosed. They will offer treatment resources to the overdose victim and the family. And where this model has been successful, such as Hamilton County, the QRT has resulted in a 35% reduction in overdoses and an 80% success rate in getting people into treatment. As I said in my roundtable speech just a year ago, in two Akron zip codes, we have the worst infant mortality rates in the county and among the worst in the state of Ohio. In November, I convened a health equity summit that engaged healthcare leaders, social service agencies, government and faith leaders, citizen advocates to help us develop a plan for intervention. It is clear that the primary driver of inequity is the shocking amount of premature births here in Akron. Participants at the summit developed two recommendations. One, the need to define success and establish community-wide goals, and two, neighborhood-level engagement around prematurity. My assistant for education and health initiatives, Dr. Terry Albanese, will continue to lead our efforts, and I'm proud to announce, with the philanthropic support of Akron Children's Hospital, Summa Health, and Cleveland Clinic Akron General, this year I will hire a health equity ambassador to assist us in achieving measurable results for our moms and our babies. Please join me in thanking our hospitals for their support. Thank you. Listen, the best antidote to crime and poor health is pretty well known. It's a job. And the pathway to jobs is also pretty well known. It's education. That's why much of my time this past year was spent in schools and meeting with local business leaders. Having taught in the classroom for about 10 years, it's a subject I do know something about. As I traveled to Akron's high schools and I spoke with principals, administrators, teachers, and students, I came away knowing that our children, they are intelligent, they are well prepared, and the notion that our schools are failing is simply wrong. And it's far past time this perception gets changed. Thank you. But even with all the good work being done, we cannot ignore the numerous independent reports which show a canyon-like gulf between the educational level of our residents and the skills needed to compete for available jobs. This skills gap threatens our region's ability to grow and attract new investment. According to data compiled by the Summit Education Initiative, there are roughly 74,000 adults living in our region with some college but no degree. That's almost 20% of the population. And if there's one achievement in 2016 that I am most proud of, is the relationship that the city has established with Stark State College to build a new downtown campus, which is a $12 million investment in Akron. Stark State will provide low-cost options for residents who seek to bridge the gap between their current skill level and the jobs that pay a living wage. And for those of you who don't know, there's a huge difference between minimum and living wage. It will also connect employers to the training and certifications that their workforce requires to to expand. We've ended the drought in Akron of being one of the few Midwestern cities without an independent, state-supported community college. And I'd like to acknowledge my partner in all of this, Dr. Para Jones, President, Stark State College. Thank you, Para. Thank you. Many of the jobs of the 21st century will require advanced knowledge and a curious mind. And while we need to increase the opportunities for workforce training, we also need the innovation of a strong University of Akron. I'm a proud partner with the university and others on an innovation center right here in downtown. It's called Bits and Atoms. And this is a project that will construct a makerspace on Main Street, bringing together professional, student, and citizen entrepreneurs alike, a place where all innovators can simply bump into each other and create. In 2016, Bits and Atoms was awarded state and federal grants totaling over $3 million. And more often than not, cities like Akron enter their research university partners to jumpstart the local economy. Patent activity and the retention of those with advanced degrees are becoming key performance indicators for cities on the rise. That's why I will continue to seek, and I have these in quotation marks, I will continue to seek unprecedented collaboration with the University of Akron, and I want to recognize my partner in those efforts, President Matt Wilson. Thanks, Matt. Listen, innovation is nothing new to our region, but we need increased scale and a lot fewer silos for innovation to flourish once again. It's through investments in technology and innovation that will place Akron among the most forward-thinking cities in the country. If I've experienced, and this is a smiley one, if I've experienced any frustrations this year, and there have been a few, and I think the source of many of those frustrations is about half the people in this room, but that includes my kids too. But if there's any frustration, I think it's in harnessing the collective resources, and Don mentioned this a little bit in his beginning, of the city, the county, the universities, the Greater Akron Chamber, and others in the area of economic development. The same reports that show our skills gap also reveal a stagnant local economy. My Blue Ribbon Task Force organized a special subcommittee to examine development efforts in and around the city, recommending that we take our strategies in a bold new direction. That's why today I am announcing the creation of the Akron Growth Council. The council will be made up of 8 to 10 individuals whom I will appoint to advise me and my team on nothing less than a transformation of the economic development ecosystem in our city. I've come to realize that the strategies that have been in place for the past 30 years are not necessarily those same strategies that will best serve us going forward. The job of the council will be to break us out of our old habits, help us generate a new strategic vision for securing outside investment, and to create an environment for new jobs with wages that will allow our residents to support their family. This will not be a strategic review that simply creates a plan to sit on a shelf, but rather a living, breathing process that seeks measurable improvements across the city. I have engaged our local and regional foundations in this effort, and I'd like to thank the Fund for Our Economic Future, GAR Foundation, Akron Community Foundation, Knight Foundation, and First Energy Foundation, who have all pledged their support. Thank you. As we build a great place to work, we must also create great places to live and play. A year ago, I promised that I would create the very first strategic plan for the largest job center in Akron, our downtown. With Susie Graham and the Downtown Akron Partnership, I have assembled a steering committee of 37 representatives of large and small businesses, finance, nonprofits, housing, tourism, and real estate. They have worked purposely and efficiently to publish 10 principles that will lead us in making decisions about downtown development. Our first success was identifying a new developer for the Civic Theater block and a new developer for the hotel at Cascade Plaza. And we hope to see construction begin soon. Additionally, through the hard work of many, Akron has secured not one, but two nationally competitive grants to rejuvenate public spaces downtown. Reimagining the Civic Commons, a grant funded through the Knight and Kresge Foundation efforts, and the U.S. Department of Transportation Tiger Grant will together provide a $10 million boost to our urban core. Thank you. I firmly believe that we are going to grow from the core out. And as our downtown improves, so too must our neighborhoods. And we aim to tackle housing first. This month, I unveiled a comprehensive housing strategy, detailed in its analysis, and clear in its recommendations. We partnered with the Greater Ohio Policy Council to benchmark our plan against best practices, and I've commissioned the Reinvestment Fund to conduct a market analysis of all 200 micro neighborhoods in Akron. What this tells us is that in many ways, Akron is still recovering from the foreclosure crisis. Beyond all the challenges that vacant housing presents, a significant portion of our housing, quite simply, is not in good condition and is not attractive to middle-class families. My strategy seeks to establish all of those conditions paramount for new and infill housing construction, rehabbing existing homes, and preserving all of our historic neighborhoods. And this is a quintessential situation where the rising tide does lift all ships. And as we implement my housing strategy, I firmly believe new and existing residents will benefit. As you can gather so far, I'm all about growth for this city. Growth in population, growth in education, and growth in jobs. And when you look at the history of our city, our biggest periods of growth have paralleled America's open-door policy for new immigrants. In the 19th century, it was mostly Irish and Germans. After the 19th century, mostly people from Eastern Europe. And I'll bet many of us in this room today have grandparents or great-grandparents who arrived here during one of America's great migration periods. Well, thank you. We'll go a small applause. But this, to me, this is what Akron is about. I got a text yesterday from a friend of mine who teaches in the Akron Public Schools, and he called to thank me for establishing the city as a welcoming city, which we have a history that goes back about 100 years of being a welcoming city. He said, I get to be a hero, because I have a refugee boy, 11-year-old, that I get, and he's scared and he needs help, and I get to help him through all of this. To me, that's the Akron that's welcoming and opens its doors and looks at it and says, listen, these are the children that we're trying to help. To me, that's where we should be applauding ourselves, is that you get a random text from a friend that you've known for 20 years and he's sitting there wanting to teach more refugees because he can help them. That's the Akron that I know, and that's the Akron we want to see thrive. Thank you. What was true then is true today. We benefit from the diversity of our population and a welcoming policy that brings people to our city from other countries. These aren't democratic principles or republican principles. Conservative nor liberal, these are American principles based on our collective humanity for over 200 years. Thank you. Unfortunately, what is happening today has happened before. And recently, I ran across this piece from the Akron Beacon Journal, and I'll just read part of it. No person of foreign birth who is a resident of Akron need fear an invasion of his personal or property rights. All foreign-born residents will be protected in Akron, so as long as they go peaceably about their business. And the writer goes on. I urgently request that our people refrain from public discussion, which might arouse personal feeling, and maintain a calm attitude toward everyone without regard to nationality. That statement, made by my predecessor, Mayor William J. Laub, and he published it on the front page of Akron's two newspapers, April 3, 1917, 100 years ago, on the very same day that President Wilson asked for a declaration of war against Germany. When it comes to being a welcoming city, let's allow our history to be our guide. Every day, I am energized to fight for every healthy baby, every graduate, and every Akron job. I am incredibly proud of our first year in office and the growth, rebirth, and the optimism we have worked so hard to cultivate together. But as I do look forward into this coming year and the years to come, I am struck by the reality that the decisions we make today have far-reaching and powerful consequences. While we continue to rise and meet the challenges of the present, we must also resolve to build a prosperous, healthy, and financially stable city for the generations that will follow. As I see it, the two most significant responsibilities that I have as mayor are, first, to protect the health and safety of all citizens, and second, to remain a prudent and faithful steward of your public dollars. While I am inspired by the potential and the momentum of Akron in this time of renaissance, I won't sugarcoat where we are financially. We do have significant challenges, and we need to have an honest conversation about exactly where we are. While the overall state of the city is strong and getting stronger, the financial state of the city is at a crossroads. Here's an analogy I often use when talking about the city's finances. If the city's budget was that of a household, it might look something like this. We would be a middle-class family. Our household income has suffered in recent years. We're doing all we can to earn more. But like many of our neighbors, we struggle to find the kind of work we had before the recession. We pay our bills, we pay them on time, every month with what we earn. But we are living nearly paycheck to paycheck. We have a mortgage, maybe two. Student loans to pay, several credit cards, nearly maxed out, and no real savings to speak of. We've cut back as much as we can over the years, but if we cut back much more, we will end up losing something very important to us, like tutoring for the kids, keeping our house safe and clean, or being able to donate to charities. We worry about things like how do we send our kids to college, and what will we do if, God forbid, the furnace was to break. This is no way to live as a family, and quite frankly, no way to thrive as a city. And as I said last year, I am not comfortable, nor will I ever be, to just manage our decline, and none of us should be. Before I entered office, I appointed an experienced and diverse Blue Ribbon Task Force to look under the hood of our city government. The task force respectfully found that the city has several financial strengths, all of which I've seen firsthand every day. Among them, a very strong management team, a strong asset base, and clean audits. I have implemented many of the task force recommendations, including health benefits reform, partnerships to reduce city subsidies, and more effective revenue collection, and a critical review of city agreements and fee schedules. Listen, since 2008, the city has lost more than $86 million in income taxes, the result of unemployment and underemployment triggered by the Great Recession. Second, only to the loss of income tax has been the loss of fair tax sharing from the state of Ohio. According to the Independent Policy Matters Ohio report released last month, Akron lost $15 million a year in state revenue sharing from the elimination of the estate tax and reductions in local government fund, in the local government fund. The casino tax, no one's surprise, failed to fill the gap. And this equates to roughly a 50% reduction in state support to provide services and maintain operations critical to our residents. The majority at the State House is proud of saying they balanced their budget. And you know what? They did. But you have to ask yourself, at what cost? The state has abandoned an 80-year agreement with cities who supported the state sales tax and income tax in exchange for an agreement to invest a significant portion of those funds back into local communities. But now, as cities like Akron strive to re-energize their local economies and neighborhoods, the state has decided to keep those funds for itself. Even as a revenue-challenged city, we must continue to try and invest in our future. We can make no excuses, and quite frankly, I will not. Our safety forces deserve to have the best equipment. Our roads cannot continue to fall apart, and our neighborhoods cannot and will not be left behind. Two questions. What does this mean, and how do we move forward? First, I will continue to cut costs and implement efficiency measures that will prevent any unnecessary spending. Second, I will focus on preserving our most critical services, police, fire, EMTs, road repair, and infrastructure. These essential neighborhood services keep Akron safe and strong, and we cannot allow them to deteriorate further. Most importantly, I will go out into the community, as I have done since the beginning of my public service career, to hear what the people have to say and communicate our needs directly to them. Together, we must do what is needed to overcome the inherited challenges and chart a pathway towards a more secure financial future. I have full confidence we will do just that. Akron is known for being innovative and industrious, reinventing itself in the face of a changing landscape. We have enough energy, enthusiasm, and determination for a city 10 times our size. It will take all of that energy generated by our collective belief in Akron to ensure that we realize our full potential every single day. And while many of us in this room count ourselves among the converted, I've heard supporters and detractors whisper and sometimes even shout, "Hey, this all sounds great, but can any of this really happen in Akron?" Let me be clear. When people ask, "Why Akron?" I say, and we must all say, "Why not Akron?" Because if we don't believe in ourselves, no one else will. Why not Akron as a city, where a new economic vision spurs local growth and attracts new investment? Why not Akron, a community where collaboration creates a vibrant, livable downtown? Why not Akron, a city that celebrates the arts, culture, and diversity? Why not Akron, a welcoming place where anyone can seek an education, a healthy start, or find their dream home? Years from now, when other cities look for a model of rebirth, someone will say, "Why not look to Akron?" As Akron continues to evolve from its roots as an industrial powerhouse to a highly creative, innovative center of excellence, let us never forget our greatest asset has always remained constant. It's been our people. This resource has fueled us in the past and will again prove to be the catalyst going forward. And as I work together with you to embrace the challenges we all face and the opportunities on the horizon, the state of this city is like my faith in the people of Akron. It has never been stronger.